the Wham Bam EAST Fan Show, Thursday, 7 p.m. on CJSF 90.1 FM with your host, DJ Medi. Hey, that's me. We'll be interviewing fans, musicians from all genres and all languages, and other talents too, like photographers and videographers. We'll check out local businesses, cheap eats and yummy treats, and also events that are happening or are not happening around town, and places to go and get some fresh air, go for a walk, and places that are still open and you can go for a shop. Although we focus on East Van, we'll be making friends everywhere and anywhere. Hi! We'll chat with skateboarders, athletes, dancers, artists, chefs, bakers, tailors, comedians. Hey, you name it, we want it. See a familiar face or a familiar place right here on the Wham Bam EAST Fan Show.
It's morphin' time.
Hey guys, it's DJ Medi here, and I am dressed up head to toe in a yellow Power Rangers outfit today. Welcome to the Wham Bam EAST Fan Show. Yes, we have an awesome lineup, but first I gotta let you know that we are broadcasting from Simon Fraser University on unceded Coast Salish territory here in beautiful Burnaby, BC. All right. Who are the guests today? We have Georgia Couver, and she is going to introduce us to her martial arts instructor, Jonathan Pang. That's right. And we also have from the DOXA Film Festival, Kenji and Joella. And we'll also be talking to my elementary school friend, that's right, William Lee. And he's going to tell us some stories of back in the day. Yeah, growing up in East Van. Okay, so let's start off the show with a band called Only a Visitor from their album Tower Temporary. Here's East and West right here on CJSF 90.1 FM. Go!
Reflections of our local beauty.
So we're heading down to China Creek North Park, and we're going to visit Georgia Couver, and she's going to introduce us to her martial arts trainer. Let's go. How do you know Jonathan?
We actually met at the Polar Bear Swim back in January 2020. And we were just having a bunch of lunch with our friends, and then we kind of swam together hand by hand. And then, yeah, he's been training me to get my ass kicked a lot.
Awesome. All right, here we go. Okay, hello, Jonathan, and welcome to CJSF 90.1 FM.
Hi.
Please introduce yourself.
My name is Jonathan Pang. I've been practicing martial arts for almost 20 years. And, yeah, so I have a couple of people that train with me on an individual basis. And I work in film. I try to get into stunts. And just steadily trucking along here.
Perfect. Yeah. And have you met any famous people?
I met Mark Dacascos and Iko Uwais when I was on Wu Assassins, so that was fun.
Cool. Yeah. All right, awesome. Okay, so we're going to see you guys train a little bit.
Yeah.
And how do people, where did you learn your craft?
I learned like specifically stick-related stuff. I learned in Toronto under my instructor, Sean Zerger. I'm actually wearing the shirt right now.
Let's see it.
Plug Zerger Academy. Yeah. He's got an online program. He's teaching through Zoom right now.
Mm-hmm.
So look that up, and you should be able to find him on Facebook.
Perfect.
And this is the facility that I trained at, the Fighting Arts Collective.
Oh, nice.
In Toronto. Is this right side up? Here we go.
Okay.
Right. We got like all these. We had all these different disciplines, but they closed down shortly after COVID. It only took a global pandemic to shut them down, so, you know.
And they don't have a branch in Vancouver?
No, they don't. No.
Okay, so, like, you're kind of bringing it to Vancouver, kind
yeah,
of?
Yeah, me and, like, two other people here are representatives of that school, I guess.
Yeah, and when did you move out here?
September 2019. Fairly
awesome.
Recent. Just in time for COVID.
Yeah. Okay, so, yeah, you're going to show me some moves. So you're going to do some by yourself, or did you want to do some with
I'll do some with my victim here.
Oh, okay, cool.
You're not supposed to call it student, dude.
You guys keep saying victim. It's a casual learning environment. Okay. Yeah, we'll do a little bit of single stick work. This is known as Balintawak. And it's a close range stick fighting system that was also founded at a fencing club.
At a fencing club, okay.
In Cebu, okay. All right. I'll feed you, I guess. Okay.
And do you just do sticks, or do you do other weapons as well?
Well, Filipino martial arts encompasses a lot. Like, this particular subset is more geared towards just stick fighting at close range. And there's also, like, knife and sword, and I get into all kinds of stuff.
That's right. And so I saw that you do a seminar.
I did. I did a little Silat Kali seminar.
Yeah, tell us about it.
Well, I was very fortunate to have a friend who runs a school out in Maple Ridge. I also know him through stunts.
Mm-hmm.
His facility is called Evolve Martial Arts.
Mm-hmm.
It's mostly a Taekwondo school. And he contacted me. He had seen me, you know, post all my videos of me training. And he thought that I seemed quite knowledgeable about all that. And so he asked me to do a little workshop for people.
Double stick?
Yes, I like to be double stick with someone.
A lot of people get enamored by the idea of double stick. You can see that this is probably the least applicable to, like, a reality self-defense kind of situation, because you're never carrying two sticks around.
That's right, right.
But it's actually really great for your neuroplasticity and brain work.
Okay.
Right? Because you're using both hands in conjunction, and you're working this coordination, and you're kind of problem-solving on the fly.
Okay.
Dancing. And then whenever one of us panics, we just kind of break off.
Oh, nice. So.
Almost hit that jump.
Georgia. So was that pretty fun?
It was a sauce time, but it was pretty good.
Yeah?
That was a good run. We didn't like break it up or anything. It was good.
So for beginners, like how can people get a hold of you if they're interested in practicing with you?
Look me up on Instagram. My Instagram handle is @kungfujp. And you can find me on Facebook too. Yeah, I'm pretty open-ended.
Thanks, guys. Thanks, Georgia and Jonathan, for being on the Wham Bam EAST Van Show. Wham Bam EAST Van!
I want it all. I want to fall for you. I do. I know it's true, but I don't want to force it up. Take whatever you give, 'cause it's better to still have you here. But I'll make this clear. Take all of me and I'll take care of you. Caress your back, I'll have your back. And yes, I know that I could get so scared of having you change your mind, but I just don't want to go.
High school, stuck my thumb out on the 99 East. I never even heard about college, and besides, the highway was speaking to me. Nothing but brick walls behind me, nothing but pitfalls ahead. If I fell in a pit and I died, would you miss me? Or would you just miss half the rent? I rubbed my dick raw to a vision of you. Hope we get married when we're 22. I hate your boyfriend and how he treats you. Hope we get married when we're 22. When we're 22. A little too much Joni Mitchell. Nearly got gored by a moose. slept in the back of the cab with your highness. I came down with a case of you. Nothing but bluebells behind me. Nothing but blue balls ahead. If I wrote it all down in a book, would you read it? Or would you just skip to the end? I rubbed my dick raw to a vision of you. Hope we get married when we're 22. I hate how you starve yourself, cut yourself too. Hope we get married when we're 22. When we're 22.
And that was Tim the Mute with 22. And before that, we had Non La with their song Wait For You. All right, next, we're going to have some recommendations on what to watch at DOXA Fest after the break.
Renaissance Coffee is open at SFU. Parminder and his team have been serving the SFU community with great coffee for more than 20 years. If you're looking for a wholesome meal, delectable desserts, or something to warm yourself and lift your spirits, Renaissance Cafe is the place to be. Featuring fair trade espresso beverages and brewed coffee, Renaissance Coffee is open Monday to Friday from 7 a.m. to 3 p.m. Well, how do you get up and go?
I know it's our last day. Let's just go out with a bang and make sure everybody is aware that, you know, this is it.
Okay.
So thank you.
We've been talking a lot about our own capacity as a family to keep this restaurant.
Very sad to see it closing, and I will miss it.
There's a beauty in having an elegant closure of an entity, of a life.
And that was the trailer for Koto, The Last Service. All right, we have Kenji and Joella on Zoom here. So yeah, let's get right to their interview.
Welcome Kenji and Joella to the Wham Bam EAST show. Please introduce yourselves.
I'm Kenji Maeda.
And I'm Joella Cabalu. I'm the director of Koto, The Last Service.
Perfect. So Kenji, tell everyone, what is the Koto?
So Koto is our family restaurant, which is based in Campbell River, and we had it for 39 years, and we closed it in 2019.
Yeah, so that's, and you said it was in Campbell River. So did your parents pick that location because of the salmon?
When they used to live in Vancouver, they actually went to Campbell River on a little road trip, and they said that it smelled like Okinawa. And so
really?
It's about the ocean, it's the water, it's those kinds of feeling like home that then they made the decision to move there.
Oh, wow. Because I've never been there. And I have been to Okinawa, and I know you're from there. All right. So, I think I'll have to do a road trip once this pandemic is over to check it out.
It's a beautiful small town.
Okay. Now, Joella, so you and Milena went to film the last 2 days. Tell us, how was that experience?
Yeah, so me and Milena Salazar, who is a colleague of mine, we've worked on many films together, and she is the cinematographer for the film. And it was our both of our first time to go to Campbell River and to also go to Kodo Japanese restaurant. And yeah, it was a really wonderful experience. I really treasure that time, being independent filmmakers. And Kenji had invited us to come up and kind of really left it open-ended, gave us some direction of what he wanted us to capture. But it felt kind of a little bit like film school for me and Milena to like just be in our hotel room and really draft up like what are the shots that we want on like a scrap piece of paper. And yeah, just kind of go out there, and it felt quite liberating to have that kind of freedom to, yeah, capture as much as we could.
How long have you been doing that?
This is my 8th year producing and directing documentaries.
Wow. And then, like I said, you were busy filming, but were you able to try some of Kenji's sushi?
I certainly did. There are actually a couple of shots in the film where I'm in the background, like in the corner, and I'm like stuffing my face with sushi. And I feel bad because Milena was still like running around trying to capture shots. I'm like, oh, you have to come eat some food too. Yeah. Otherwise, I look bad.
Kenji, but we... Kenji, do you still make sushi here in Vancouver?
I do not make sushi in Vancouver. I think I needed some time off from making sushi in a professional setting, but I'm sure I'll at some point come back and do it.
Right. And did your dad teach you?
Yeah, it was my dad and my brother who taught me how to make sushi from a very young age. The restaurant opened, our first restaurant opened in 1980, and I was born in 81. So I literally grew up in the restaurant, surrounded by food, surrounded by my family. And it was a really great experience to understand not only food safety, but like cultural practice of creating food. And it was really great.
Wow. And how were the customers at Campbell River there?
They I think when we first opened the sushi part of the restaurant, there were struggles to try and introduce raw fish to people at that point. But
yeah, because up north, they're not used to it, right? Like they're not exposed to sushi up there, right?
Exactly. And so and one of the biggest things that my dad tried to do is just make sure that people felt comfortable about what they were eating. But now, of course, many years later, Japanese food, sushi is just a staple for many people. And so it's been really great to help transition some people into having really delicious food.
That's awesome. Okay, so as you know, May is Asian Heritage Month. I just wanted to know who inspires you.
Joella, do you want to do that?
Sure.
Yeah, I was thinking about that question, and I just realized that during the pandemic, it's been hard for me to read books. It sounds kind of silly, but there has been one book that's been really inspiring, and it's called Minor Feelings by Kathy Park Hong, and it was released in early 2020. And it kind of is part memoir, part critical essay. And it's really timely thinking about her experience as an Asian American woman growing up and becoming an artist in the US during like the 80s, 90s, and up until now. So that's been really affirming to read, and also know that there's other people out there who are feeling the same kind of feelings.
Good, how about you, Kenji?
It's hard for me to choose one person because over the many years, I've been inspired by so many great Asian leaders here, especially in this region. I think about like Sherry Yoon, who is the artistic director of Boca del Lupo, Howard Jang, who used to work at Arts Club, but now is at the Banff Center. These are the types of individuals that I looked up to as I moved into my career in the arts and culture sector, because they're the ones that paved the way, in addition to so many other people. So I'd say that I'm always inspired to see the next generation of arts and culture leaders as well. So it's hard to choose one.
All right, Joella, so we're going to go back to you, and I'm going to ask you, this is a radio show, so do you know any local bands?
Yeah, well, not necessarily bands, but there are musicians that I really am inspired by. And one is Kim Mortal, a queer, non-binary Filipinx rapper, musician. I'm really inspired by their kind of their artistry, and have used some of their music and some of my demo kind of work. And I just love listening to them.
I sink into it, submerge my cloudy head. I'm crying underwater now. Until these flowers give me powers, I think I lost something. It's all going too fast for me. I keep swimming in the memories. Can someone please just
welcome back, folks. Okay, so we're going to find out how we can watch the film. And is it called The Koto?
So the film is called Koto, The Last Service. Mm-hmm. And it will have its virtual world premiere at DOXA Documentary Film Festival, which runs from May 6th to 16th.
And how much are the tickets?
I actually don't know. But, Kenji, you want to jump in there?
Yeah, I think it's $10 to attend one of the, we're part of our shorts program. And so you buy tickets for that shorts program. And so in addition to our film, you get to watch, I think it's three or four other really great short films.
That's awesome. And DOXA has so many more films. Can you recommend any others to look out for?
Yeah, I love the short films this year. There's a couple. There's one that's called Nude to Me by Danny Barish and Ryan Ma, and it follows the director's journey to discover how his grandparents met at the first or oldest nudist club in Vancouver. they're on the cover of the Georgia Strait. And there's also a local doc called The Tomahawk by Leanna Patrick, which is kind of a portrait of the Tomahawk restaurant in North Van.
I love that restaurant.
Yeah, so definitely check out the short films.
Perfect. How about you, Kenji? Any of your recommendations?
I haven't been able to watch any of the other films yet because it's Joella has some early access to some of the films, so she's kind of lucky with that. But I'm really excited to watch so many of the films during the festival because DOXA has it's very close to my heart, that organization, and they screen really great films every year.
Perfect. Okay, so is there a website that people can look for more information?
Yeah, for DOXA, you go to doxafestival.ca. So it's doxafestival.ca. And you can scroll through and find all the really great films that are screening this year.
Awesome. Well, thanks, guys, for hanging out with me, DJ Medi, on the Wham Bam East Van Show. Oh, and what do you like about East Van?
I live in Mount Pleasant, so that's like very much on the border of East Van.
No, oh, you're East Van. Mount Pleasant's East Van.
And I've been here I've lived in this neighborhood for 10 years, and I just love how walkable it is. It's so many great restaurants and so many great parks too. So that's what I love about East Van.
I used to work on Commercial Drive for so many years, and I love the neighborhood. I love all the cafes and just the parks in that area too. So that's, I definitely miss being there on a daily basis.
All right, thanks guys. Wham bam.
East Van.
Right, see ya.
Bye.
But it was only detrimental. That's why I know for sure I always wanted more. But it's the worst kind of memories, omitting bad things you did to me. Can't escape this lie, I'm stuck on good time. I'm lost in nostalgia, can't seem to get out. Del veravent
چنان در دل من رفته که جان در بدنی
That Chinese Show is a two-hour music and spoken word program.
In our first hour, we'll be bringing you a wide selection of Chinese instrumentals and pop music, as well as showcasing a Canadian band each week.
During our second hour, we'll invite famous Chinese doctors to discuss about healthcare and experts to share their opinions on important issues in China.
Tune in to That Chinese Show every Saturday from noon to 2 p.m. on CJSF 90.1 FM.
每周六中午12点到下午2点 欢迎您收听CJSF90.1电台的 That Chinese Show 家中音乐中医保健时事评论 愿 That Chinese Show 伴随您度过难忘时光
And yes, we have a Chinese show on CJSF called That Chinese Show. What do you know? All right. And before that, we had Tissa Rahim with her song Missing Love. All right. Next, we have a very special guest. He is a friend of mine. He's from my elementary school. And he's going to talk about what it was like growing up in East Van. Here's Mr. William Lee.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to CJSF 90.1 FM. Here's Willie. Sorry, Linda, I gotta get that out of my system. I always wanted to do that. Well, thank you very much for having me on the show. It is a pleasure and an honor to be here. Well, first, let me introduce myself. My name is William Lee. I have known Linda for over, 30 to 35 years? Sorry to expose your age. Mind you know, Linda looks like she's still 15 with those pigtails of hers. Anyways, I've been in Vancouver, especially East Vancouver, all my life. I went to school here, went to university. I'm currently a logistics manager for my own company. I move shipments with trucks within North America. And I'm also a part-time realtor, just for fun. on my free time, I like to do podcasting. I do a bit of video singing. I love badminton and also like to chat with friends like you guys. Well, Linda and I have met at this wonderful place called Grandview Elementary School. It is wonderful, especially to me. Many of us were new immigrants to Canada. And we were all scared. So it was a place, almost like a melting pot for these kids, right? And it is also a place that kind of supported each other and we kind of learned together. And so it felt like a big, big family. And especially for myself, there are many first-time experiences actually happened at this very place. For example, it's my first time that I pick up a hockey stick and I joined the hockey team, you know, in the school. It was so exciting to play hockey. Man, it's really fun to meet other friends and also work as a team. And so that's one thing. Second thing was I actually learned to play my favorite game, badminton, at the school. First time I pick up my racket and I didn't know how to play. And I thought playing badminton, the goal is to hit the ball back to the opponent, so that we can continue rallying back and forth. Anyways, I also met a very, very loving lady. Her name is Miss Beedham. Miss Beedham was my homeroom teacher, and she was also the music teacher for the school. So she got me into music. It was my first time ever learning how to sing Christmas Carol. So most of my songs that in my early years that I learned, they were all Christmas carols, believe it or not. She is a very, very wonderful lady. She actually spent her own money so that she can send kids, especially the underprivileged kids like myself, to summer camps every single year. And I'm not just talking about one kid or two kids, I'm talking about the whole class. She actually gave me the opportunity to go camping with other kids to see the great outdoors of Canada. I love that lady so much. And as well, I shouldn't say this on the show, but it is my first time. I wouldn't say fell in love, had a feeling for a girl who was one gray higher than me, and I made the biggest mistake. So story goes, the girl and I actually ended up in the same summer program together. And actually she came up to me and asked if she wanted, you know, if I could walk with her to school and from school. So obviously being, you know, excited and ecstatic, I went to my parent, went to my mom. I said, "Mom, oh no, you know, this girl is gonna pick me up. I'm gonna walk to school and blah, blah, blah." And that was my first biggest mistake in life. Guess what? The day that the girl came to pick me up, the very first day, my whole family was standing behind me with a big grin on their faces, and they were like laughing and talking behind my back. Oh, so this is the girl that William likes. I was so embarrassed. So as you can see, lots and lots of warm memories and loving memories from that place. So fast forward a few years, I was now in high school, and I think it was grade 9. So one of my best friends came to me and asked me, "Hey Will," because I said, "What? Do you want to join choir?" Oh, by the way, that's how we talk, you know, we were going through puberty. It was cool to talk like that. So anyways, so why? Don't you want to join something macho, you know, more like things like woodwork or metalwork or even auto shop? Why do you want to join choir? So sissy, you know? So my friends said, "Come on, don't be an asshole, come." So I went. So I went with him. So the minute I walked through the door, I said, "Oh man, you, I knew it." Because you know what? I walked in the class and all I could see were girls. 90% of the students in choirs were girls, and that was why he wanted to join choir. It's, you know, there's always got to be girls, you know. So I like I said, so I walked in with him, and I met my choir teacher in high school, and his name is Mr. Collins. And Mr. Collins was wonderful too, and he taught us many of the hits in the 70s, 80s, even the 90s, right? And we actually sang a lot of the songs that were famous Broadway plays, like, you know, Phantom of the Opera, Les Miserables. So I really got into singing. And at the same time, it was like 1997, many of my friends came from Taiwan and came from Hong Kong. And so it was that time that the karaoke machine was invented. Oh boy, let me tell you, we sang day, we sang night, and we were practicing so much that, you know, that, you know, back in the days you practice on your own, right? And then you perform that song that you've practiced a lot in restaurants, and then you go up there and you sing and you make yourself feel good. Oh, I'm a mega star, right? You know, not that we were any good. So long story short, my passion for singing has grew exponentially from there on. And I have been singing, you know, off and on throughout the years. And not that I'm any good at it, but I enjoy singing because it releases a lot of stress for me, and it makes me happy. I don't know what it is. Maybe it's the oxygen that I breathe in. I get a sense of high, natural high, when I sing. So I'm gonna share with you a song that I sang recently. It is a Chinese ballad, and I actually produced an MV for it. So the song is about this girl waiting for her lover to come back, and she has been waiting for years and seasons, and he still hasn't come back yet. So yeah, it's kind of romantic, or you can say it's kind of sappy, but most Chinese ballads are like that. Anyways, and the title of the song, loosely translated, it means I have been waiting for you to come back for so long that the flowers have withered away. So I don't know if that makes any sense to you. So hopefully you enjoy it, and I'll see you after the song.
春夏秋冬的过了难道还不够其实是因为我的心有一个借口等待拿走的人把它还给我每个人都在说这种爱情没有 结果我也知道你永远都不能够爱我其实我只是希望你有时想一想我你却已经渐渐渐渐什么都不再说我睡不着的时候 会不会有人陪着我我难过的时候会不会有人安慰我我想说话的时候会不会有人了解我忘不了你的时候你会不会来疼我 你知不知道我等的花儿也谢了你知不知道你知不知道我等的花儿也谢了 说话的时候会不会有人了解我我忘不了你的时候你会不会来疼我你知不知道我等那花儿也谢了你知不知道
Hey, welcome back, people. Hopefully that wasn't too agonizing or unbearable, I hope. Hi, Linda. Thank you very much for having me on your show. It has been a blast. Thank you. And guys, maybe you can take it from me. Start singing. You know, I think singing can keep your mind fresh, keep your mind positive, and get that creativity flowing, right? So on that note, I wish you good health and be positive and take good care of yourself and your family. See you again soon. Bye-bye.
Thanks, Will, for the great advice. All right, now I am so curious to know, if you attend Grandview Elementary School right now, do you guys still sing the Grandview song? It goes like this. Grandview School, Votrico. Grandview School, na 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 na, no Draco. North, south, east, west, we're from everywhere joining to sing to you. All right, I'll stop singing. All right, we're going to wrap it up here anyway. So yes, I want to thank all of my guests for participating, and I want to thank you for hanging out with me, Yellow Power Ranger. Yeah, baby. Okay, so next week we are going to have Eddie Lam Halen as our guest. So let's end with one of his songs, his all Asian band. Here's Cry of Silence right here on CJSF 90.1 FM. We'll see you all next week. Bye. Next Up is a hip-hop show called Next Up. You're listening on CJSF 90.1 FM. This is DJ Mehdi signing out. Wham Bam, East Band.